Yes, the relay on YouTube. Check it out. Lots of stories about me on there. All the boxing facts and info that you want in a very entertaining, educational manner. The relay. Check it out on YouTube.
Welcome to the motherfucking relay, where we're covering today's top boxing
news.
You know, yesterday it was announced that Nicola Adams has so decided to call it a career due to medical reasons, that any more prolonged injuries to her eye could result in irreparable damage and vision loss. Oh. Thus, at the risk of this, Nicola Adams has so decided to hang up the gloves and walk away from the sport of boxing, and all we can do is react to it. I want to preface everything I'm about to say with this. There is no room for criticism here. These are not critiques.
Can't do it.
These are not harsh judgments in regards to Nicola Adams, because her reasons can't be debated.
Can't be judged.
Least of all amongst the spectators. The spectators aren't the ones that would be running the risk of irreparable vision loss. So they don't have the precedence. I don't have the precedence to levy any kind of criticisms towards Nicola Adams for retiring. There's no grounds to do so. All we can do is react to it, discuss it, and share our thoughts. I'll say that even though Nicola Adams didn't quite get the chance to make history as a professional, she did make history in the sport of boxing overall as an amateur. She was the first woman to win an Olympic gold medal. She is, in fact, an Olympic double gold medalist. That's not something a lot of people can call themselves. You know, a lot of people, they don't win a gold medal, let alone two. In that way,
she made history.
Nicola's legacy as an amateur fighter is cemented. But as far as, you know, what she managed to accomplish in the professional ranks, there is a feeling that her pro career ended before it started. That's the feeling that I get. You know, very recently, she was in action against Salinas in what was supposed to be Nicola's defense of her WBO title. She won the title while it was vacant. Areli Musinho, the then WBO champion, she actually was supposed to fight Nicola, and Areli had to pull out due to injury. Thus, Nicola was elevated to full champion, full WBO champion. That's how she got the title. Well, she went to defend that title against Salinas, and she languished. It wasn't a good showing for Nicola. It really wasn't. And
post-fight,
after the fight, there was a feeling of, you know, Nicola really is on borrowed time. The clock is ticking, because Nicola then, 36 years old, was going on 37 years old. 37 years old, you got four pro fights, you just had your fifth, and there's not a lot of time there. You know, that if you're going to do something major as a professional, you really don't have that much time, because Nicola was an aging fighter. She started in the pro ranks, you know, kind of late. So seeing her retire now at only 5-0, it really does give off the sense that her career kind of ended before it started, because she never actually got to have that big signature fight or to unify titles with another world champion in her division. These are things that, you know, they just didn't happen. And it's because time ran out. I reiterate, Nicola's retiring due to medical reasons, so that can't be debated. That can't be critiqued. That can't be criticized.
It can't.
Okay? She's not going to run the risk of going blind to entertain me and you, and I don't blame her. I don't blame her. All I can say is I had hoped to see more. I had hoped to see Nicola, you know, eventually, you know, get to have a robust body of work as a professional, perhaps unify titles with a champion since she became a belt holder herself. All things considered, it's a pity that it didn't get to work out this way. I'll say that I always wondered why Nicola ended up on the Queensbury Promotions side of the street with Frank Warren, as opposed to over there with Eddie Hearn and Matchroom. Matchroom, who I think would have done a better job with Nicola. I dare say that I think that Nicola Adams would still be boxing here today if it were Matchroom that were guiding her career, as opposed to Frank Warren. I'll say that. I believe that. I think that Matchroom would have gotten more out of Nicola and what was left of her, you know, because she started so late as a professional. I feel like Matchroom would have gotten more out of her than Queensbury did. She might have actually still been boxing today, all things considered. But with Nicola, it was always a time-sensitive issue. You know, Clarissa Shields, she's a gold medalist, like Nicola Adams is a gold medalist, but the difference is that, you know, when Clarissa debuted as a professional, she's only 21 years old. She's only 24 years old now. There's lots of upside there. Lots of time to make a lot of things happen. Whereas for Nicola, she debuted at 34 years old. 34 years old in 2017. You know, Katie Taylor, she debuted at the age of 30. She debuted with more upside, more time on her side than Nicola. Nicola debuted at the age of 34. That doesn't give you a whole lot of time to have a robust body of work as a professional. It just doesn't, you know? I mean, you'd be working at an accelerated rate for what is already such an accomplished amateur with all that wear and tear. It was a tough ask. I'll say that when I heard the news, I was actually stunned. I didn't expect it. But when I thought about it, it did make a lot of sense. It did. 37 years old, you just had a really hard fight. Doctors are telling you, you know, you get hit in the eye, you might not be able to see out of that eye. It makes sense. So the most I can say is best wishes to Nicola Adams in whatever chapter of her life, whatever new adventure she has. She's already made history for the sport of boxing overall, for the sport of women's boxing, and for the sport of boxing overall. She has. So there's worse ways to retire. There are worse ways to leave the sport than by choice. And I think she's made the right one overall. So, you know, congratulations to Nicola Adams on making history, and you know, hope she has a bright future in whatever she decides to go on and do. And the most that I can express is that it's just a pity that we didn't get to see her do more, that the time did not allow for Nicola to have a professional career that is tantamount to her amateur career. That's the most that I can express. That it's a pity that she didn't have the time to do these things. But you know what? She did make history, so that's saying something. And the news, I'm sure most of you have heard already that Naoya Inoue has signed with Top Rank following his big win in the World Boxing Super Series. He's just inked a co-promotional deal with Bob Arum's Top Rank that will bring Inoue to ESPN in the coming year. In the article, it talks about how Top Rank is turned to the WWE to help build Tyson Fury's American profile with the American public. It talks about how they've been experiencing some difficulties in securing big matches for Terrence Crawford. And, you know, we're just going to have to wait and see what they have in mind for Inoue. And I'll say that even though Inoue and Crawford, respectively, are on the same side of the street, or they will be, they're not in the same boat. It being that they don't have to worry about any cross-promotional, cross-network situations stifling fights for Naoya Inoue. The big ones, the ones that he needs, the ones that he's looking for. You know, a fight with Nordin Ubali, an MTK Global fighter, that's an entirely doable fight, and the stage is already set for that fight. I've talked about it in passing already. The same is true in the case of Zolani Tete, WBO champion at the weight. Zolani is a Queensbury Promotions Frank Warren guy. Frank Warren, who's already in bed with Top Rank. Thus, that is yet another doable fight. A doable fight that Zolani Tete himself is saying he wants. Right there with Nordin Ubali. You know, Nordin Ubali, he's been flying largely under the radar. Most of the attention that any world champion has been getting at this weight, at bantamweight, really has been reserved for Naoya. But Ubali's let it be known several times already that he wants that Inoue fight. And that's the fight that makes sense. You know, these are the fights that make sense. And on the Top Rank side of things, they are entirely doable fights. So Inoue won't experience the difficulties that Terrence Crawford is experiencing when it comes to unifying titles and being in big fights. The only curious aspect of this move is that since Naoya Inoue already has a massive following in Japan, a massive following that I've no doubts has grown due to this morning's fight or whatever, because, I mean, if you weren't a fan of him already, certainly this morning's fight will bring you over. You know, his celebrity over there in Japan,
he's a star,
has been amplified by this fight. So you wonder, what's here in America that he can't get over there in Japan? He can sell tickets over there, far more tickets than any bantamweight fighter can sell over here. We all know that the guys at the lighter weights, like bantamweight, here in America, they don't get the attention from the casual observer, from the casual audience. The casual fan here is likely either watching the welterweight division, the middleweight division, or the heavyweight division. Essentially, the glamour weights. Whereas guys at bantamweight here in America, they fly largely under the radar. So even though certain fights are now made even more accessible to Inoue that he's in bed with Top Rank, you wonder if coming here to America is the right move and what's he going to get out of it. Could they have sold 20,000 tickets for Inoue versus Daenerys here stateside?
Could they?
I dare say no. I dare say no. No, I don't think they could have sold that many. I don't think that fight would have got the same attention, the same fan reaction here stateside that it got over there in Naoya Inoue's backyard where he's already a superstar. So that's an interesting component. The Top Rank means to bring him over here, but if Naoya Inoue's worth any kind of money to anybody, it's not over here. It's over there in Japan, where he's a superstar. I guess the idea is to make him a superstar here in America, but I think that's going to be a tough sell because Americans don't really watch the lighter weights. That's just the reality of it. Oh, hardcore's over here. They know about Inoue. But when you bring a guy over here and the plan is to make him a star, you're trying to sell him to the casual fan. And the casual fan doesn't watch bantamweights. They don't. They just don't. For one reason or another, his stateside, that's just not one of the glamour weights. Interesting component, though, to the boxing fan, the one already acquainted with Inoue, right? The ones who already know about
me and you.
It doesn't really matter. It's neither here nor there because what we're looking for is for the important fights, the significant fights, and those fights are now made possible, more possible, since Inoue is on the Top Rank side of things. So there's that. I guess it's a compromise. He's compromising his celebrity to build a profile here in America, and that might take some doing. But at the same time, he will get access to the kind of fights that he's looking for. I just thought it was interesting. I thought it was worth noting and mulling over that a bantamweight, who can move 20,000 tickets in his own backyard, is going to be brought over here to America, where I can't think off the top of my head a bantamweight that could move that many tickets. I mean, when's the last time you remember a guy at 118 pounds moving that many tickets, getting that kind of a fan reaction at bantamweight in America? I don't know, man. You know, a part of it seems counterintuitive, but at the same time, another part of it seems necessary. Because if you want Ubali, if you want Zolani Tete, well, this is one way you can go about getting them. And I think that, yeah, those fights are now more likely to happen. I don't think that the very next fight we see Naoya Inoue in, I don't think the very next fight is going to be a unification fight. I don't think. I don't know. I mean, I don't know how fast Top Rank is going to decide to hit the gas on those kinds of situations. We'll see. You know, we'll see what happens. Maybe he fights a mandatory or somebody like that. You know, via the WBA, the highest ranked contender via the WBA is Liborio Solis. Whereas via the IBF, their highest ranked contender is Michael Das Marinas. This is per their last set of ranked standings, and we know that these are the world titles that Naoya Inoue is currently in possession of. A few familiar names in the WBA's ranked standings. We see that Luis Neri is there. We also, for some reason, see the name of Guillermo Rigondeaux there. I wouldn't worry, you know, too much about those guys. I wouldn't pay much attention to those guys because those are PBC guys. And what are the odds that the PBC is going to bury the hatchets with Top Rank and really start working together to make all the fights, all the interesting, significant, and important fights? I stand by my original assertion that, in all likelihood, both Luis Neri and Rigo end up procuring some kind of baby belt, you know, some kind of WBA gold or WBC silver or WBC Latino or something, and they end up defending those baby belts as opposed to pursuing fights with the actual champions. Something very semblant of what we're seeing at 175 pounds, to where there are plenty of world champions to go around, but the PBC's guys are happy playing musical chairs with baby belts. I think that's what's going to go on with Luis Neri. I think that's what's going to go on with Rigo. We know that Luis Neri has expressed a desire to fight Naoya Inoue. We know that he has said that. We know that he's already faced one common opponent, you know, with Inoue. He's faced Payano, and he's about to face another, the former IBF champion, Emmanuel Rodriguez. But I don't view these fights as a prelude to Neri versus Inoue. I just don't, because the PBC's business practices, they really haven't changed. And I don't think they're about to start now. If you can let a big fight like Crawford versus Spence sit on the shelf just to keep things in-house, a fight at bantamweight isn't going to coax you to change your business practices. If that didn't, what will, you know? So I view those guys as non-factors to Naoya Inoue's reign as a unified and what could be an undisputed champion. And finally, a revealing quote from one Tyson Fury insights into what he thinks about Joshua versus Ruiz, too. He says, "It can go either way. I think Joshua is going to try and make it boring, use the jab, but then again, that only works until you get tagged. And then you get tagged, and you'll start fighting, doing what you do naturally. So that's what will happen. Listen, I don't know. I'm not Nostradamus. I hope Joshua wins because it puts him back in the mix for a big fight with us. Because Andy Ruiz ain't really that big of a draw. I hope Joshua wins, but I see Ruiz doing exactly the same thing again." And that's a very interesting quote because it denotes what I've been telling you guys all along. That the heavyweight division needs Anthony Joshua to win that fight because no other fight with any other fighter can provide the life-altering money that a Joshua fight can get these fighters. That Joshua's fan base, the support that he gets, and the marquee value that that generates, nobody else has it, not like him. So the heavyweight division is actually better off if he wins that Ruiz fight. Now, whether or not he will, that has yet to be determined. But when Tyson Fury says that he sees this fight going the way that the first fight did, I can't agree with that because the circumstances have changed. This is not a short-notice opponent that you have no real insight in, no insight to. Anthony Joshua and Andy Ruiz both have experiences from the first fight to draw from. But in many ways, this isn't the same Anthony Joshua, and this definitely isn't the same Andy Ruiz. Some images have been circulating of Andy Ruiz in preparation for the fight, and he's noticeably slimmer than he was the first time out. Where Eddie Hearn says he saw the guy, and he didn't look any different than how he did in the first fight, you'll look at these images and you can see that this is a smaller Andy Ruiz, a much smaller Andy Ruiz than the one that Joshua fought the first time out. There's also what I mentioned before, that this time out, they're having a full camp. Not only do they have their experiences with each other to draw from the first fight, but they're also having a full camp. This isn't spur of the moment. This isn't all of a sudden. This isn't a stand-in opponent or a stand-in situation. Anthony Joshua now, more than before, knows what he's dealing with. A lot of time, a lot of effort is going into the preparation for the Ruiz rematch to ensure that Anthony Joshua gets those belts back and assumes his seat as the top dog in the heavyweight division. That's what's going on. They're bringing in sparring partners with very similar dimensions to an Andy Ruiz, but more time is being spent on it. Thus, I don't view this situation as being identical to the previous situation. How could it be? And Andy, approaching the fight so much slimmer than he was the first time out, well, it lends credence to my previous notion that approaching the fight as a smaller guy than he was the first time out might come at the compromise of his power or his speed and his counters. Those will be there, but there won't be as much weight behind the punch. And what he can take, what he can absorb, being a smaller guy, well, it may lessen, since he won't be as sturdy, as portly a fellow as he was the first time out.